A very good morning to all the delegates, senior faculty, postgraduate students. As the Dean of AIIMS Mangalgiri, I welcome you all to this elaborate arrangement because AIIMS Mangalgiri is housed in this temporary campus of Siddhartha Medical College. Well, this morning I am chilled by this arrangement done by Dr. Venkatesh, Dr. Anil and his team. They have done it from scratch. And I'm also thrilled to see my colleagues from Mumbai, Dr. Nemade. When I saw his trial slide, non-CBE said omnibus, it shows KEM. I'm also proud to represent Grant Medical College, Mens Sana in Corpore Sano. I proceed to my presentation, which is vascular anatomy of the hip joint and its surrounding structures. The arterial supply of the entire hip joint is very crucial because of its intricate arrangement around the femoral head. The oxygen deprivation or ischemia results in the necrosis of the head, which deals with your bread and butter, that is asking for an endoprosthesis. Therefore, during hip surgery, the neighboring arteries need to be preserved. All of you left your embryology years back, so just to revise a bit on the embryology, the first evidence of vascularity occurs at around 8 weeks of intrauterine life, and then this vascularity proceeds post-conception to elaborate because of the weight transmission. By the 14th week, a ring of vessels has encircled the femoral neck and these form the primitive retinacular vessels. The primitive model does not change unless until till the 14th week of skeletal maturity. The postnatal vascularity can be divided into three distinct supplies: an extracapsular ring of vessels, ascending cervical vessels and intracapsular vessels. The extracapsular ring comes directly from the femoral artery and travels around the femoral neck as the medial and lateral circumflex vessels. During growth, the contribution to the overall supply of the proximal femur by the medial circumflex increases, whereas the lateral circumflex vessels contribution becomes significantly less. By the age of 10, a 50% decrease has occurred in the number of vessels along the medial and anterior aspect of the neck. This has important implications for vascular preservation during femoral neck osteotomy. The ascending cervical branches from the extracapsular ring pierce the hip joint capsule and travel under the synovium along the neck inside the hip joint. The intracapsular synovial ring of vessels ascend superficial to the perichondrial ring and supply the epiphyse. In this way, the physis serves as a barrier between the blood supplies of the primary and the secondary centers of ossification until the two supplies coalesce at skeletal maturity. This is a diagram showing the blood supply by the medial and lateral circumflex femoral, the obturator and the superior and inferior gluteal arteries. The blood supply of the hip joint to the intracapsular neck and the head of the femur again has got three main sources: the acetabular branch from the obturator artery, that is called as the medial epiphyseal artery, several branches from medial circumflex femoral artery, lateral epiphyseal artery, few branches from the medial circumflex femoral artery, which supplies lower or the metaphyseal part of the head of the femur. The blood supply to the intracapsular neck and the head of the femur, the lateral circumflex femoral artery mainly supplies the femoral neck at its anterior side. The blood supply of the acetabulum is completely defined before birth. The incidence of acetabular side avascular necrosis, either idiopathic or iatrogenic, is very low. Superior gluteal artery, it supplies the superior portion of the acetabulum and the weight-bearing dome. Most of the inferior acetabulum is supplied by the posterior branch of the obturator artery. A small watershed line in the posterior acetabulum is redundantly supplied by the inferior gluteal artery. So if we take a schematic diagram of the acetabulum in a form of a clockwork, then we find in case of the right acetabulum, the superior and inferior gluteal arteries exit the pelvis at the greater sciatic notch at 10 o'clock position. The superior gluteal artery supplies superior and anterior aspect, that is 10 o'clock to 4 o'clock position. Inferior gluteal artery supplies the posterior aspect, that is 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock position, whereas the obturator artery exits the pelvis through the obturator foramen at 6 o'clock and supplies the acetabulum inferiorly within the 4 o'clock to 8 o'clock position. Going to the next thing, that is corona mortis or the crown of death. The retropubic vascular connection between the obturator and external iliac or inferior epigastric arteries or veins occurs in 10 to 30% of the subject, whereas cadaveric studies say that they occur in about 84%. I had the opportunity to present a keynote address at Indian Society of Hip and Knee Surgeons at Falaknuma Palace in Hyderabad in 2012. I had the opportunity to work with numerous orthopedic surgeons at my alma mater as well as at D.Y. Patil Hospital, where they used to come down for numerous cadaveric workshops. So based on that, we did a statistics which accounted for 84%. It is typically located around 3 centimeters from the pubic symphysis. There's a venous connection which is even more, almost 70% than the arterial connection. It is present more in females, but there is no literature why it is more in females, and it is approximately 2 to 4 millimeters in size. Most of the cases it is above 3 millimeters. The laceration may result in a catastrophic bleeding. The potential risk factor for significant hemorrhage in pelvic fractures, pelvic trauma, pelvic and acetabular surgeries. It is a challenge to the surgeon and hazardous to the patient for anterior approach to the pelvis like ilioinguinal approach and intrapelvic approach. Intraoperative ultrasound may be able to identify this artery during surgery. The next shows anatomy of the corona mortis, while in a CT, the asterisk mark shows the hematoma over the right obturator canal and a bilateral corona mortis which is on above the pubis. The branches of the femoral, inferior gluteal, superior gluteal and obturator arteries together with branches from the internal pudendal artery of the perineum interconnect to form an anastomoting network in the upper thigh and gluteal region. The presence of these anastomotic channels may provide collateral circulation when one of the vessels are interrupted. The next slide will show us the different cruciate and trochanteric anastomoses which are established around the trochanteric fossa at the back of the hip. The arterial anastomosis around the hip joint is mainly because of anastomosis between the superior gluteal and because of the ascending branch and the transverse branch of the inferior gluteal. Apart from this arterial supply, the venous drainage is equally important. So when we talk about blood supply, it is arterial as well as venous. The veins, most of the times, they are numerous because of weight transmission, because of venous return, but the major veins, they correspond to the arteries. The surrounding structures which are present are the muscles, the ligament. They derive branches from the superior and inferior gluteal artery. These are my references. Last but not the least, my teachers have helped me learn and grow. I thank all the teachers for helping me to learn and grow, for knowing when to hold my hand and when to let it go. The same teachers told me a mushaira. That would be the parting line. Main ja raha tha zindagi ke sadak pe. Main ja raha tha zindagi ke sadak pe. Ek taraf thi chhai hariyali, ek taraf shamshan tha. Ek taraf thi chhai hariyali, ek taraf shamshan tha. Pair mein chubhi haddi, haddi ka ye bayan tha. Haddi ka ye bayan tha. Yun na fainko mujhe, main bhi kabhi insaan tha. Thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Venkatesh.